with?
It's just, they figured it out, basically. Mm-hmm. It's an item that enhances your Crypt Storm damage and your Spirit Siphon damage, and it gives you armor. So it's like everything DP needs. Because normally she has to go like tanky HP like Bloodstone or Soul Booster for Octarine Core. Now she can just buy a Veil. It's like 2,200 gold, and she's got 6 armor right off the bat. It's exactly what you need to protect against heroes like Weaver.
And the Lore of HP region on top of that.
Yeah.
Draft is ready, so let's drop you into that right now. We've only had a couple of bans. Doom and IO, nothing surprising so far.
I'm actually surprised that NewB bans out of Doom instead of DC.
I mean, they both played a lot.
I mean, both of them use it as it's one of their top three hero picks over the last 3 months, so it's not really surprising that they would both, or either, but...
And there goes the Ricky.
Yeah,
so they... the Bounty Hunter, though.
That's a good point.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So what does DC do? Do they go with the Bounty ban? Do they go with the Beast ban?
I think Beast is more important.
I agree.
Yeah.
I think they're more afraid of the Ricky than the Bounty just because of that smoke cloud. That thing is so annoying to play against, especially for carries. If you notice, like, House spends, even as a Weaver, spent so much time in that smoke cloud, had to go MKB just to counter it.
And the amount of time it takes just to kill him. Like, even when you think he's gonna die, he pops his ulti and he buys himself 3 to 5 seconds of invulnerability. Like, even if it does no damage, your value's there. And then your smoke cloud's gonna be off cooldown again when you pop out. Right. And you can blink strike. It's actually quite good defensively as a support.
Like, they want NewB to pick Beastmaster so they can pick Bounty Hunter themselves right now, DC.
Just while we're waiting for the first pick, I just want to throw this one in to you. Fogged Gods, Aldi, and Winter all had DC top 8.
Okay,
it's just like, I don't think that's ridiculous. I think
congrats to them!
Black's like, whatever!
I think I put them at 10th, or 9th maybe?
Yeah,
I think
around.
I put
them
like
around
9 or 10, yeah.
Yeah, so I'm... It'd be surprising if they win here, definitely. But they've really shown that they're still a very good team.
Oh yeah, they should be very proud of themselves
right
now.
Yeah, absolutely.
They've come a long way.
And I wouldn't even necessarily say that, like, they're kind of a newish team, you know? They haven't been around that long, it's just I feel like everybody had doubts. That's
yeah,
it.
Well, yeah, I mean, they've come compare up... them, it's EG and Secret at the same time. This team formed at the same time.
Remember when they first formed? And they were losing to a lot of North American teams in the Vigor. They lost to Shazam a bunch of times.
That's true.
And they really struggled to find, you know, how to play together. To be fair, a lot of them were like all over the world. Like, they weren't all together in Suns Fans Mansion. But, you know, it was rough in the beginning for them.
So we've had the Lion first pick. Again, one of the top three most picked heroes from the last 3 months for both teams, and there's the Batrider for DC. Are you surprised that they've let that go, or did they not have any option? They had to get rid of the Ricky. They were never going to ban the Batrider first phase.
I think for them, they're more comfortable at dealing with a Batrider than a Ricky, which is something that they typically don't see.
Yeah.
And so, not that surprised, but I am surprised that they let it go, and that they picked up the Lion instead of the Bat.
I don't completely agree here. I just feel like Chuan's Lion is so good. Like, he's going to be able to move around the map, get things done, secure kills.
Wow.
There we go with the Bounty.
But Batrider is such a comfort pick for Mu.
It is.
It's like, that guy plays it so many games, and he is... The way he plays it as well, it's like really aggressive, in your face, sometimes he dies, whatever, but he makes space, he does things for his team.
And on top of that, KP plays an amazing Batrider too.
Yeah.
5 seconds. Can't forget that fact. But I mean, like, Lion is Chuan's best hero, so I understand why they would pick it. But I don't know if Lion is not a bit too vulnerable against Batrider and Bounty together, because he actually doesn't offer that much in the early game.
I feel like it comes down to whether or not NewB can get Invoker on top of that, and they could hypothetically pick it here. Just because if you have Batrider offlane pressuring a dual lane, then Lion sets up the stun, it won't be Invoker because they have a DP, but...
I think they pick DP because if Bounty roams on a DP, you can siphon her and you actually won't die to the gank. It's one of the stronger heroes against the Bounty roam, but... I don't know. They definitely need to ban Invoker now, NewB does.
10 seconds. Yeah, I agree. It'll be like last game if they don't.
Yeah, because else Invoker will just free farm and you can't really prevent it and it will be out of control again.
Or you could do something like Death Prophet and let them have the Invoker, but also pick a support that can roam on the Invoker, like an Earth Spirit or something like that.
That's a good point. The cool thing about DC's draft right now, though, is it's a cookie cutter of what they did last game that was very successful. They have a roaming Invis hero that provides some team fight help, and then Batrider, and then... They can just keep going the way that they need to. Same as last game. If they do that, I mean, Bounty is different than Ricky, so it may not provide exactly what they need, but it should keep them in that comfort zone. So that's a big thing for DC going forward to game 3.
We see DC actually ban out the Earth Spirit.
I like that a lot. They anticipate, hey,
aggression in the middle lane.
Yep.
10
seconds remaining. What's the other support that you would fit into that category, though?
Ooh.
Do you think Venge is very likely here since they they're gonna have Fire Rider again?
It's unreliable. They have to be really out of position for you to be able to go on the on them with a Venge. Like if the wave is on their hill, you're not gonna kill them with a Venge.
Definitely not. But they can't do both. They can't both protect mid while roaming.
Right.
While also countering Batrider.
Yeah.
Also,
it looks like they're not really worried about any other support I can roam because they banned off their Nyx against the Batrider.
And NewB just says, you know what, I don't want to deal with this at all. We're just going to ban out there.
I like that ban.
Do they get the Phoenix now on DC's side?
Bounty Phoenix is really greedy, though.
Yeah, that's really greedy.
You have no disables on any support. Like, your roaming is going to be. It's not going to be that good.
Do you need disable when you've got Sunray, though?
Yes, you do. You always need disable.
Kidding. I'm just kidding. 5 seconds.
You didn't want to hedge your bets on that one?
No, I did not. That one was a joke. Don't need to hedge my bets on jokes.
Okay.
I'm still mad. Don't be.
Do you want to hug later?
Yeah, that'll help, actually. I'll take that one. Off camera, though.
Well, you're not going to get it from me.
I just don't want to ruin your tough guy image, is all.
I can do it. My hugs are good. Got positive feedback on those.
Well, what are we going to get out of DC here?
They need damage for sure. They have two heroes that don't offer a lot of damage, but a lot of vision and disable, just utility in general. So
if they had lifesteal or not banned, this would be the perfect lifesteal.
Yeah, I was
it should be a melee core because of track. Track is already so good with Batrider, that's another thing. Bat's gonna be running fast because everybody's track. They should probably pick melee chaser sort
right.
of core.
I kind of like something like a Sven. The armor does well against DP Ghost.
I wouldn't say no to Lycan. Lycan doesn't really care about Lion at all.
Lycan's banned. Lycan's banned.
Never mind. No Lycan, guys.
Disruptor's a solid choice.
Disruptor.
Yeah. Got some good win rates.
Bounty Disruptor is really good. You track someone, then they want to disengage, you just glimpse them back. It's like really easy.
Yeah, they have
really
way more
combo too.
They have way more mobility than NewB does.
Right.
Like, mm-hmm. It's not even close. Especially with Disruptor now, like you said. They can punish, they can escape, they can punish. If DP uses ult, they can probably get out in a lot of cases. Flame break plus that mobility means.
Yeah.
You saw the Disruptor do a lot of work against the Disruptor in the first game.
Disruptor against who?
Disruptor against the Death Prophet, sorry.
Death Prophet, yes.
Yeah,
it was the other way around.
It's not your traditional sort of gank mid, but if he gets out of position and you run forward with a Death Prophet and or you run forward with the Disruptor and maybe one other hero, you glimpse the Death Prophet back, Death Prophet can't fight against like three heroes. So.
Let's say Bounty's level 2 has an AWP of Venom, you hit him once with a Jinata, there's no way Disruptor won't reach him, he will just be there, glimpse him back, and it's a free kill for three heroes.
Yeah. We spoke a little at a... I think we had a question, didn't we, from the social media, where they were saying, which heroes do you think will come to the fore? Disruptor wasn't necessarily one of those at the start of this tournament, but it's now the fourth most picked hero.
Yeah, I would agree. We definitely forgot about him. He's been
wrecking
every game.
He's definitely one of those
game.
Ones. It's just quietly come back into the meta.
We've seen so many good Disruptor alts as well that change fights. If you notice, like, the first game, Resolution tries to go on the Disruptor, and then he's just like, oh, hey, I'm silenced, and I'm in an ult. I can't do anything. I'm dead.
Field, you're like, okay, I guess I'll just be stuck here for 5 seconds almost.
It's great at zoning, it's great at punishing, it's got chase, lock. I think a lot of us have forgotten about it, but it used to be one of those it used to be a CIS support. It was really only the CIS teams that picked it a lot, but I think a lot of people here are realizing, yo, this is really good.
Especially because of the increased amount of early support items, I think Disruptor is better. He's pretty item independent, but things like Raindrops help offset his lack of stun, his lack
Windlace.
Of survivability. Windlace helps with mobility, chasing heroes down. There's like so many little things that help Disruptor have more impact early.
What do you think about the Phoenix though? I think Bounty, Batrider, and Disruptor are all very good against him. They can disable him or like cancel the Sunray from a very long distance, and that's essentially why you pick a support Phoenix.
That's a good point, but with that said, if DP is the focus of battle, Sunray on him is going to be really good. So,
right,
it could offset that.
I just feel like one track on him and throw a shuriken, it's like
oh, that's a good
cancel.
Point, actually, They have really good ways to stop
it. Yeah, it's not tagged the best of tournaments and has been falling out of favor in the meta. Still the third most pick, but 28.5% win rate on Phoenix.
They also don't have a real good way to combo with Phoenix ult just yet.
Yeah. He just eggs, and then they punch the egg.
And then the egg dies.
Yeah. Jaro doesn't care, because he's like, flat cannon, egg, right click.
Yeah.
Doing everything.
On your BKB, flat cannon, boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, this is actually the most BKB Jaro game I've seen in a long time.
Oh. Void, yeah, well,
maybe not now, but...
But, like, still Void good. And Phoenix are always, like, the butter combo, bread and butter combo. There's no better combo with that, especially if you have a DP on top of that. Like, they do need another damage core now, though. Like, a good position one damage core.
Yeah, if NewB lands their skills, namely Chronosphere, and gets value out of DP ult, then they're gonna wreck fights. But if they fall flat on those a little bit, or they're out of position slightly when they initiate, then DC should be able to kite and win every fight.
But so DC needs to be really careful. They do not have a single save against the faceless Chrono. And if you don't have that, it can get really, really messy. Because you can just lose your gyro instantly to a DP old Chrono, and then you can't win a fight, you can't fight anymore. You have no DPS from the three heroes, Bad Rider, Disruptor, and Bounty.
That's really true, actually. It's kind of a one-core lineup, which is
so far.
No one does.
So far.
I mean, they're going to pick a farmer for Wii for sure. That's what they always do. They usually run two cores. But even so, you lose one core, it's like half of your damage, pretty much. Mm-hmm. And you need to be really careful.
This game's going to be about who starts the fight.
Right.
If Digital Chaos can get off a good Batrider Lasso on a core hero that into a Disruptor ultimate, then things are going to look real good. But if NewB gets off the initiation and can successfully kill a hero in Chrono, especially a core hero, fights are going to be really bad for Digital Chaos, because you're right, they have no damage after that.
Yeah. What do you make of the Meepo ban? I generally feel that Meepo is very weak against Void in general.
I think it's also not great against Death Prophet.
There's like a lot of respect.
They're scared. That's what that is.
There's a lot of respect.
I would have been okay, if I were NewB, I would have been okay with Digital Chaos picking Meepo here. You have a Lion, Death Prophet, Void.
They're more scared about the playstyle, I think, than they're scared about how the hero matches up against their heroes.
To be fair, though, every Meepo hit on the egg, like, if you have five Meepos in the egg,
that's true.
In like
oh,
one
yeah.
second.
That's true.
Slurk, that's a hero everybody's kind of forgotten about, but I thought was going to be one of the big heroes coming in the tournament.
This is, like, the perfect Slurk game.
Yeah.
Like, Bounty, Bad Rider, Gyro, they can't do anything about you.
It's a mobility counter.
Right.
It stops track movement speed, it stops Firefly. If he lands pounces on a couple big heroes, that's great.
It's not the greatest synergy with Void, but I don't think that matters this game.
Well, there's DP and Void that already have the synergy.
And Phoenix,
on top of that. Yeah.
Okay, so Dragonite to be tanky and to take the focus of damage, I guess.
I'm not a fan here. Dragonite loses against Death Prophet. Dragonite might get a little help with the Bounty Hunter, but I don't think it's enough damage.
DK will need damage items for sure.
Yeah.
Alright, thank you very much to all three. We'll hear from them at the end of this game, where the first series will be decided. Let's go back to our commentary team for Game 3.
That's right, it's Game 3 time! DC versus NewB! The Americans are pushing the Chinese to a deciding matchup. I don't think a lot of people would have easily predicted that, even though I've seen my Twitch and Twitter were all just like, hey, Western media sources, we're going to say DC will win.
I like how you abandoned the whole Australia aspect that you were trying to get into earlier, as soon as the series is tied up.
Just to say, the hopes of Australia rest with NewB. NewB have been adopted because KP is the only competitive Australian in the entire scene playing for NewB. Let's go to the game. And welcome back for game number 3, Australia versus America, NewB versus DC.
Yeah, okay, Toby. All right, so we already had some early movement. Pretty natural, every single one of these games, the laning phase is oftentimes going to be determined on what kind of wards you can get down. And this time around, you did have KP an early TP out and an early counter ward laid down to block out the hard camp. We saw the similar situation where they were running KP tied in game number 1, where he got the ward, the observer ward, out to be able to block out the hard camp. This really helps him, it seems, as he seems to be very determined to try and make the laning phase work, even if he's up against a bad matchup. He's not one of those players that just defaults back to Iron Talon. And I think it was something that we talked about, is the fact that KP is a space creator in many ways. I think the draft as a whole, Digital Chaos, I think they were a bit behind in the draft, but drafted the exact heroes they needed to. the second pick Bounty Hunter and the third pick Disruptor are two different supports that you need to be ahead and you need to be aggressive with. Those are two heroes that don't do a whole lot if the enemy team is ahead and they're five-man pushing into you. So they drafted a Gyrocopter, which is a great team fighting hero, one of the best heroes you can get to get aggressive and establish dominance at 15 minutes and hopefully be able to utilize that to get more glimpse kills, as well as the follow-up Dragonite, which was necessary, I think, to be able to get your pushing power in. Charlie made a good point that the laning phase matchup will not go well for Weeha, but I think in the end, it is the hero that they needed to have to make sure that this game ends on time. Otherwise, they're looking at the ticking time bomb that is Slark.
And the lineup can always change, the matchup can always change when you see that rotation coming out from the bounty. But for now, it's down on bottom lane where KP, like, they want to initiate in on him, but Misery, he didn't go for Glimpse to start with. So it was just Thunderstrike. They're just trying to force KP out. But KP's willing and ready to try and fight it like this. That's the reason why he brings down so many consumables, tangos, as well as having the stout shield and salve. He's just trying to weather the storm of this offlane of newbies.
Yeah, exactly. He's going to get poor man's shield. He has extra regen. He knows he can just go run forward and try and challenge Digital Chaos as much as possible, which is why Soxa is doing what he's doing, right? He's trying to actually secure the safe lane first by putting pressure on KP, making it so he doesn't get that faster level 2, and forcing him to oftentimes time walk in scenarios where he's not actually going to get a whole lot of value. Level 1 time walk is a very long cooldown, and when he's forced to use it early, it just means that Misery can come forward and abuse KP really aggressively.
I think you'd be more concerned once level 2 comes up on Misery. Top lane looks like a little bit of trouble here, but there's no, like, Stun was already thrown out by Chuan. It's just that timing you get. Also, to see another hero with level 2 is having Kaka, that Phoenix of his. Right now he's got Icarus die, but what happens once that Sunray comes up and you get yourself a good stun on the Batrider? How are you meant to escape as a Batrider?
Man, Weeha's doing pretty well for himself. It does get more dangerous as you start getting level 4 and 5 on the Death Prophet, as that Spirit Siphon causes a lot of problems for any melee hero matchup like this, but he is doing a really good job getting the CS that he is. He's managed to pick up every range creep despite Brief Fire, and is actually even CS right now with the Death Prophet.
Moo? Sentry's down. That's one thing which NewB definitely has improved on. You run, like, in both Game 2 and now here in Game 3, like, you have that Invis hero. It was Ricky in Game 2, is now the Bounty Hunter in this third game. They had a Sentry on bottom lane, which got deep warded out, but it allowed KP to at least know when that rotation was coming, and they put the Observe Ward in the bottom river. So you understand, like, the two points where the Bounty wants to rotate from. When he's out of Invis, they're able to see that movement and prepare for it. When he reaches the lane, the Sentry's already down, you're already feeling solid.
Even little things from newbie supports are really impressive. Like, even just now, Kaka used Sunray on the neutral camp to help clean through it faster. He made sure that the whole entire camp would die to maximize their experience from pulls, because they're not rotating and trying to put pressure on Weeha, so they need to actually maximize what they're doing with the neutrals. Those little things are actually really impactful, especially when you're running up against a four-position roamer, like the Bounty Hunter, who's naturally going to fall behind in experience if he isn't actually able to obtain some kills or be a part of something big. They still need to address this stack of Mu, and I believe that's what Chuan should be trying to do. Normally you would have a counter ward placed out.
He could actually lose his life if he tries to go for this too hard. There's your Bounty Hunter slowing him down, and Chuan actually just does a straight TP out. He doesn't want to take any kind of risk. And this will actually allow for the stack to be completed by Mu.
Yeah, he's got a... Chuan went back and picked up an Observer Ward, though. So he's probably going to get some vision.
Rocket Barrage going to start. He can't time walk out this one because of the glimpse. He wants to time it better, so he time walks down. KP reads the situation perfectly, but still barely surviving. The TP will complete. The beautifully played by KP, realizing that the way to escape was not back to his side of the river.
Yeah, exactly. He doesn't blow the time walk early, waits for the glimpse to be forced down from Misery, and then, you know, obviously the time walk into the side shop was just that extra little bit of really great tactical play. Chuan, as he rotated back, obviously had to TP back to base. He's going to use his positioning to make sure he secures the rune up next, and I think from there try and see if he can find Mu midway through clearing through stacks again.
Well, here he comes, in towards the middle lane, starts with Chuan, goes for the stun, Mu starts with the Spirit Siphons, Weeha, he needs help, he's TPing in right now, in the form of the Bounty Hunter, but Weeha, how much life, the stun raised out from Kaka, he'll trigger the dust, which actually reveals the Bounty Hunter, he can't get the kill over on the Phoenix, and now may lose his own life, the stun from Chuan will connect the tower to attack damage, also doesn't do enough, they tag teamed it around their line, so Chuan and Kaka are so low, But the kills are kills, however. Goes to Phoenix, goes to Death Prophet, and yeah. That's first blood.
Again, Chuan Kaka with the team play around that tower. Both of them are probably one or maybe two shots away from getting hit by the tower and dying and actually having an unfortunate trade-off there. But extremely well played. Good rotation there from Chuan. And being joined by Kaka actually really cinched that kill. The Sunray, obviously, that pure damage ripping through any strength heroes, particularly strength heroes that are overly reliant on armor. That pure damage of the Sunray is particularly effective.
So you now have those two kills coming out. You've got what was already a favorable matchup for Mu becoming a lot more favorable. How does this now work for DC? Are you delayed? Like, Weeha is going to hit level 6 soon. Do you still feel strong enough that you could pop that ulti and try and harass down the mid? Or is it just going to be a waste of an ultimate and try and use it somewhere else for a fight?
Well, the part of the problem is that the Bounty Hunter as well as the Batrider aren't going to be able to rotate and do enough in this sort of game.
Glimpse, bottom lane, they're going to drag it back, and KP. Well, actually, he's still got Time Walk.
Yeah, he's always going to hold on to that. He'll never use it in an escape unless he's forced to after a glimpse is used.
Okay.
So, the problem is going to be, I think the Gyrocopter is actually going to be resolution when he hits level 6 or 7. He's going to have to rotate around, right? Because we talked about establishing aggressive, and it'll also be able to buy space for the Disruptor to get his level 6 sooner.
Weeha may possibly actually just walk straight away safely.
Boo was picking up the runes, so he wasn't around.
Now Weeha came back in again. The Sunray is going to turn on, and Weeha, he is going to burn right now. Like an Englishman in the sun, he will die underneath the tier 1 tower. Three hero kills now going the way of Newbee, and that's Mu with Exorcism. They're going to do a lot of damage this tier 1.
Yeah, these kind of supports are always free to rotate when you have a safe laner like Slark, because Batrider can't abuse him. In fact, Hal, if he gets this pounce, he might even get the kill. Mu trying to juke it out, but not going to be able to get it. Pounce lands, and that should be a free kill.
Perfect spill damage. This is Newbee. We had game number one was pretty dominant inside. Now the middle lane, the fight's going to keep going. Mu wants to force this out a little bit harder. But Exorcism still got a couple of seconds left. Resolution burning. Kaka, the damage is too much. Misery trying to glimpse him away. You'll still end up losing the Death Prophet here.
Yeah, but it cost them Gyrocopter. Not really worth it with Digital Chaos Blow. The Dragonite ults, like, that was supposed to be their big play when they moved the Gyrocopter into a lane. It's supposed to be a one fight, but instead it turns into a trade. And that's just because a great read by Mu is the Death Prophet who turns and fights. He doesn't like the moment, just like when we were talking about before with the Faces Void in last game, game two, where Mu turned in Chronosphered instead of trying to get out. That's the exact kind of play you need to do. When you get hit by that Thunderstrike, don't try and run. Try and fight into it because you're just inevitably going to give away a free kill anyway. So that play is actually what kind of makes that even trade-off.
And they're not going to stop here, DC. They're bringing more and more numbers towards the mid. The Bounty's been sitting in the back lines, but here they go again, realizing the Weeha can be initiated on. Mu now rotates over, looking for the kill over on Chuan, but Sunray does so much until the glimpse pulls him far enough away. Weeha gets back up the hill. Now the cooldown's trying to connect. You've already brought down the Lion thanks to the Batrider, and with the damage, have they got enough going underneath the tower? Kaka's gonna drop. You've got the support from DC. Mu is still burning inside the Firefly, but he wants the kill over on Mu. The Firefly will run out. So they get a revenge kill over on the Batrider, but DC trying to preempt that movement from Newbee. They had the more than enough numbers there.
Yeah, exactly. Like this general escalation of war that it always happens against Newbee. If you try and fight Newbee, they're going to bring three heroes to mid when you've brought two. Then they bring four heroes. Well, Digital Chaos are like, fine. We'll bring all five heroes to mid, make this a full-out war. And of course, Newbee are a little bit later as the Slark. Hal was having a lot of fun time just free farming top lane, and he's not ready to really get active unless he's forced to. So he was a little bit later to the fight. Still went okay, though, because they traded two supports for an offlaner. They keep the Batrider a little bit down, and that's important, right? Because Mu, the only reason he was able to have so much effect in the last game is, first of all, better map control from Digital Chaos, but also the fact that he was slow on picking up the drums, but once he had it, he almost immediately had a blink dagger because of a great team fight. If they can keep Mu locked into just the drums this time around, Newbee won't have to worry about that impact nearly as much.
It's a little difficult when you use the resource of KP. KP actually had himself a triple stack of creeps on that bot lane, and was using it to try and deny the wave up time and time again. And then you rotate the Batrider, the guy who is now a full level in front of KP, the man who didn't want to come to the fight because he was still looking for Chrono before he had any kind of major influence, and then he just flash farms up the stack. So the Batrider now just moves so much further ahead as far as comparison to the Faceless Void.
And the reason that Digital Chaos are, they're essentially going into this mid lane fight at an inherent disadvantage because what Phoenix does. Phoenix, as like Sunray as a hero, essentially, is able to sit back, throw down both a heal and a lot of damage at the same time, thanks to it piercing through these heroes. So it allows the mid lane fights to be really easy for a Phoenix to execute. The problem is that the other option for Digital Chaos is going up to the top lane with their gyrocopter, and that's just naturally going to be a risky gank.
Got a pounce, but he can't keep the fight going as he's out of range of the Sentry Ward, which was on the hillside. A DC will smoke up behind their tier 1 tower after that smoke from Newbee. It was like a bottom lane rotation, a thought about the mid lane rotation. Now they jump up, they find Howl, they need to keep that vision on him, however, but straight into Shadow Dance, attempts the TP out, and he will be successful.
No flame break moves, only level 7. It's natural for him not to have that that's done just yet, but it does mean that Slark is able to get away. This Mu should know, though, that he's going to be wrapped around on this mid lane tower, and I think he's just trying to position himself. Yeah, hard right. So he's pulling the creeps off the tower, slowing down the push of Digital Chaos, while simultaneously not putting himself in a position to get caught.
At DC, really want this tower. When Weehouse starts taking up the tower like that to keep the catapult alive, you realize they're doing as much damage as possible, but at the same time, you've still got KP on the bot lane, farming up, he has a TP scroll, and he has the Chronosphere. So while that tier 1 tower is up, Newbee can still bring that big AoE teamfight controller to the fight straight away. And in fact, now with a pull up from KP, like, Resolution can see him. Misery would have to get the perfect glimpse on him. KP is having a very long walkout with the ulti. This time around, Time Walk won't allow you to escape, but with extra support coming in from Newbee. Resolution, the Sunray goes a little bit wild trying to heal up KP, as opposed to finding the kill and then the perfect chrono. It catches out Misery and makes sure that any TPing support from DC would not be able to affect the outcome of that, aka death of the Disruptor.
Oh yeah, it's 5-manning time for Newbee. Look at that. Time to rotate 4 heroes down to the bottom lane. Really great timing and they're punished like that. But it's just everything to do with this lineup and the way that Newbee play, that they're always going to be buying space with each other. It's normally you would see this sort of 5-man scenario that Newbee like to do. Other teams would be punished by naturally falling in a gold and experience disadvantage because they just don't farm as efficiently. But the way this draft is set up, the supports have really high impact in the laning phase. They're able to get kills with any of their cores. They just rotate 2 into any lane and it's a potential kill. And then on top of that, they're still able to win or at least draw even in team fights 4 versus 5. So there's always a situation where Hao can be farming up the top lane trying to finish up a Shadow Blade, or conversely KP can get a lot of free farm at the bottom lane as the Faceless Void. It's just the nature of this lineup. In Digital Chaos, that this is why they're at a disadvantage when it comes to the draft, is that they're forced into this scenario where they have to be super active, but they don't have very high success rates with their ganks. It's just not very natural. You have to go into a Death Prophet with a Phoenix backing him up. That's not a good idea, but it's what you have to do. The other side would be trying to what, gank up a Slark? He pops the R button, he's away. Like half the time that gank's just not gonna be successful. So if you blow a smoke, rotate 3 heroes to top and Slark survives, it's so much wasted time that you end up being completely inefficient.
And it seems now that you're gonna see the fallout from that, especially the Bounty Hunter. You got Saxa on 4 levels only. You don't actually have the track up yet. This is taking time, and until you have a successful fight, he's not really gonna find those levels. And even after that, you need to have a secondary successful fight to get him the gold and start getting the rest of your team the gold.
Yeah, but remember when I was calling, I was talking to you about the draft, and I thought like Juggernaut last pick would be a really good choice for Newbee. If you look at the difference of what Juggernaut gives you in Slark, Slark isn't threatened by a Batrider, right? So if they go for the smoke rotation up the top lane, he pops his Q button or his R and he's away, right? But a Juggernaut, his defense mechanism is of course his spin, and he would just get lassoed up and killed anyway. This is why they went for the Slark, because it allows you to be able to have that top lane guaranteed. It's just not going to be ganked up most likely, because it's just a low percentage gank is what we call.
Here comes the movement right now from DC. They really want to try and find that tier 1 tower. If they can find a hero with it, they'll definitely take it. This is at the same time as Newbee rotated move to sides. They know Chuan's in the tree line. Just the way the smoke broke, that it was just very obvious that Chuan was there. The impound will only hit over on Misery, and with a creep skip from Mu, that tier 1 tower will end up going down.
Oh, Resolution's not going to expect this one. It's an early Shadow Blade.
Oh, with a run forward, the cooldown. Resolution tries to create space, but KP makes sure he's going nowhere. Again, very deep on the Chronosphere, but still ensuring that one hero is caught inside of it.
Yeah, look at that trade-off. DC rotated 4 heroes to top lane with a smoke, got a support in a tier 1, but Newbee immediately responded in the mid lane with their Shadow Blade, gank up the gyrocopter, much better kill, and will now be able to take the tier 1 themselves, because how can DC fight without their primary teamfighter, the gyrocopter. He's supposed to be that 15-minute monster that allows you to bully the enemy team, but he's not here.
Yeah, even if he comes back to life again, that cooldown is still on cooldown for another 21 seconds. And AP, he's just hovering around. There's no chronosphere available, but how? Oh, okay, the grid's going to come back into it, so that's going to be at least a nice little thing. But the T1 tower was still brought down. And the trade-off was the fact that Bounty Hunter got picked on the back line. He walked in range of the sentry ward. So it's still a little bit more trade-off. Okay, this is nice. A glimpse of move. That Nova is well out of position. So you do not have that for the fight. This is a good one for DC. Now with the cooldown, KP has a time walk it out. The move's in close until the Sun Ray and Kaka. They're just burning DC. Misery wants to run, but okay, a little bit of life is not going to be enough. Kaka will dive himself forward. So even with the Nova having no influence there, you got the glimpses back, you forced NewB to fight, and they were happy to do so.
Yeah, Kaka's idea of that Nova was that, okay, Death Prophet's out of position, but he'll just run himself back into the Nova, and DC can't pursue. But then you see Mu realize, with this Vitality Booster and my Strength Trance, I'm actually tanky enough to enjoy just all of this damage being put on me. I'll out-heal with the Spirit Siphon and the Sun Ray being comboed up towards the end. I can survive through all of this, and we can still fight this one despite the glimpse supposedly putting me in a bad position.
I don't know exactly what went wrong there. They tried a bottle refill, but didn't get it off in time. So that bottle's still empty for the Death Prophet with the TP mid.
Digital Chaos had a lot of success. Ooh, Kaka. He actually thinks he can do this one solo.
He's try with the dust.
He missed it.
Yep.
He popped the dust when he was obviously back to his original Icarus Dive position, was too far away, so... Still, that's some serious confidence, right? If like Phoenix thinks he can solo kill the Bounty Hunter, it shows what nasty position Digital Chaos are in.
It's level 4 Sunray. You can kill anything you want to.
That's a problem, right? The 4 position, Riki had a lot of success because the way Misery played it, he was very disruptive to the greedy 4 position Beastmaster that NewB was running. Yep. He was disrupted during the right times, played around the Beastmaster for the first 4 minutes, and then once Beastmaster started getting a little bit levels, he started playing around the laning phase. This time around, because DC picked up an early 4 position that's kind of the same roaming style in the Bounty Hunter, but there wasn't that greedy 4 position of NewB. NewB just realized, okay, we're just gonna play really really static with our laning phase with the in the beginning with the Death Prophet, make sure he doesn't get ganked up, and then we're just gonna rotate our 2 supports constantly and out gank essentially the Bounty Hunter, and he's had no impact almost the whole entire gank. He's only just now gonna get his level 6, and that's supposed to be the big idea of a Bounty Hunter, is winning fights and getting extra gold, and 17 minutes in, that only just now coming online, it's too late.
And even that, he has to leech it off the bottom lane, making sure there's no one farming on the lane because they don't have any confidence to stand on the lane. So he can't even take the money as well. NewB is going to try and take more from them with the big smoke invasion up towards the Radiant Secret Shop.
Yeah,
they're hoping they can catch the Batrider and then just force into the buildings.
They knew the Batrider was farming up that camp. He now shows himself in lane. Mass TPs might actually counter this, but it's not enough.
Oh, they're bringing it in, and okay, they actually pull it back out again. They don't want to go for it. Except the fact that Mu is dead. And instead they get a trade-off. It'll be the T1 tower
in the
mid lane.
NewB are not going to give DC a single tower if they can help it.
Bounty at least sees it. He's coming from behind, and they glimpse back. Because of that deep vision, the Phoenix is removed from this fight. You have Faceless Void available with Chronosphere, and with a finger stun, they're already killing off Misery. So you take out a huge controlling hero from DC. They want to get a revenge onto the Lion. Chorn will trigger off the dust, but there's no one to really follow up, but everyone's rotated. And it's KP, they catch out Weeha in that top river, and even a double damage from Hal just to make this fight even better for him. Weeha, TP out won't happen. The Yules will end up canceling it. Kaka, they're on the front line. Say goodbye to Weeha. NewB just rotating so quickly, they realize T1 tower, like, don't hold it in the mid lane, but they take a huge fight against DC.
Yeah, this is why NewB are able to do so much five manning. Oftentimes they know the right ways to be able to punish the enemy team. It's naturally going to be, once you start bullying the team, they're going to try and play in every lane that you're not. NewB, don't even give up a tier one for free in that scenario, despite what should have been, okay, we got the bat and tier one for tier one, that's the favor to us. But no, they're saying, we're not going to give DC anything, no openings whatsoever. We're going to keep their cores down to as minimum items as possible. We're going to fight them in mid, and while they do get the tower, it doesn't really matter. NewB obviously come out on top with several pickoffs. Weeha, his progression in items is just going to be too delayed to have an impact in the mid game. Only having that armlet, he needs that BKB desperately to be able to just stand up and get out damage during the time where Lion's going to be most impactful.
I'm trying to keep my eyes a little bit closer over on this Bounty Hunter. Sucks that this time around, He's able to leech some experience and keep eyes on NewB. This is allowing DC to know where they can move and also know where they can gank. Four heroes smoked up, you know, invade over the riverside.
This is what's called a desperation smoke right here, Toby.
They at least don't have detection.
DC need a team fight badly.
Without the detection, NewB, there's too many heroes missing on the map. They've cottoned onto what's going on.
Yeah, it's the fact that Digital Chaos didn't push out their lanes first. The top and mid lane were okay, but bottom lane was pushing in pretty aggressively. And it's that position right there that kind of signals NewB as to the smoke. If there was one person maybe showing at bottom, pushing out that wave, the NewB would be a lot more open in their positioning, and maybe a four-man smoke could catch them out. But that's the position that DC are in, right? That they feel it's necessary to get all five heroes together. Otherwise, they don't seem to have a hope of winning it.
Well, NewB now walking as five as well. They push the Slark out in the front lines as the bait. While everyone else sits behind. At least they are finally taking that farm on bottom lane. So Resolution, it really hasn't been the greatest game for him so far. He's gone 0-4 on this gyrocopter. Can't hold on to much of that money, only having an S and Y as well as the phase boots. You even wonder, like, what really item can turn this game around for him.
There isn't a whole lot. The idea of the gyrocopter is that he comes online very early and is able to establish dominance, but there's not a really big peak after that, right? He just kind of like stays relevant throughout the game because he wins team fights and progresses in items. But if you never actually win a team fight at 15 minutes and he just kind of stalls out, he becomes a very ineffective, not that hard hitting that you really want. Meanwhile, Slark only amps up over time.
Yep. But it's the gyrocopter, it's the top net worth over on DC. Yeah. And now we're into a trade-off position. Like, it took NewB 3 hits from a Slark to kill off that tier 1 tower. It's already chipped down pretty hard. So DC, in the time it takes him to kill off just that tier 1 tower on bottom lane, the tier 2 tower and the tier 1 tower being claimed by NewB, and they can keep going. All ultis are up from NewB, so we're 21 and a half minutes in, and NewB all ready to come up to the high ground to look at the tier 3 tower. Even if they don't go all the way up, it's just to force DC back to their base and to stop that bigger trade-off going the way of DC, aka damage to tier 2 on bot.
Yeah, I think we've seen this progression in the last 6 months, where teams no longer try and, when they're in a superior position like that, right, where you're pushing tier 2 and the enemy is pushing in tier 1, you always keep going instead of trying to back out and defend your tier 2 because you're not set up to be able to defend. And because of that, Digital Chaos could actually be able to get the right kind of initiation or opening to be able to win a team fight. So instead, you force the enemy team to come to you. You're in the superior position, you keep pushing, even if it means just poking at the tier 3, force the enemy to TP back into your play, and that allows you to also hold map control as well.
Great ward from Suxa. He's able to see the movement coming up from NewB in towards the mid. It's still on top. Weehawk being slowed down by that Rod of Atos and into the Sunray. Weehawk just can't walk away. They commit the Chronos for it. Well, they really want that DK down. And they're able to claim him. Karkar is not a healthy man. But he's still able just to jump himself out. But the Bounty Hunter is not so lucky. Easy rotation from NewB on the back of the Exorcism. They're going to head into the pit. And Roshan looks prime for the taking here for NewB.
Oh yeah, that's perfect. You use Exorcism to be able to win a fight, and then you can just transfer straight into the Roshan pit with half of that Exorcism still up. This should be a free Aegis, and NewB can continue to fight at this point. They don't have to wait and like farm up at all and try and finish up a Scotty. They could do that, right? They could naturally just let this game stall out, and the Slark will out-carry the Gyrocopter in a 1-to-1, and everything else of NewB actually scales really well over Digital Chaos as well. But with this Aegis, this now means that NewB can be super aggressive. They don't need to try and spend time farming at all. They can just let Hao be on the front lines, and even if he only has 2k HP, you know, times that by 2, and Digital Chaos don't really have a hope of being able to get more than one hero kill in a team fight.
I don't fully understand exactly what DC are trying to achieve here in the mid. The Disruptor was in there with an Invis rune, but no Static Storm, so they didn't have the big ulti control. It's like they wanted to get a pick over on the Lion, but didn't really find the opportunity to go for it. So now they're getting a lot of information here, which is kind of funny, because it's all going to disappear. The gem is over on the Lion. Now all of DC's aggressive wards, and also the fear for the Bounty Hunter that he goes anywhere near gem vision, just skyrockets.
Yeah, remember how much information Misery was getting in that last game? An early gem being picked up by Chuan is going to make sure that Digital Chaos stay behind.
Well, at least they might be able to snipe a courier out if... nope, he can't even reach the courier in time. That had a blink dagger on it as well, so that would have been a really worthwhile courier to kill.
Oh, and they...
He still wants it. Nope. Okay, died at neutrals. Know. That's not. You can't deny a courier that way. Okay. Hello, bounty hunter. Why do I feel like we literally just watched fate?
Yeah, this is getting worse and worse over time. The bounty hunter. This is why I'm not a big fan of it in the first 1-2 pickups, that all you have to do is just counter his laning phase and then play a lot of 5-man. And Bounty Hunter is super ineffective in teamfights when he's lacking any gold from track kills. Mm-hmm. So once if you're never able to get that spiral rolling and get the early mech that is usually supposed to be the advantage of a Bounty Hunter pickup because he gets track kills, you don't have that. You don't really have any teamfight presence. The 5-manning is always going to be stronger from newbie. And they'll be able to bully down towers as well, thanks to a Death Prophet pick from Mu.
Hal's ready to go on bottom lane. He's already got the Silver Edge available, so Resolution. He'll let the cooldown go over, it's going to do minimal damage, and he can't TP. Well, he actually can TP out, he doesn't feel confident enough to do it now. Okay, KP, you have to commit Chrono. Resolution's going to get out. They didn't just lock him down with Chrono. They thought they had enough to do it without burning their big ultimate. And that allows the escape of Resolution.
Oh, but Zoxa, he's going to be found again. Chuan manages to grab him with a gem, just needs a little bit more mana, and then takes him out with a finger.
A little too easy with Chuan. There's a reason why this hero is banned time and time again up against newbie. And this is one of the fun heroes I always love watching newbie pick up. It's the hero that can get solo pickoffs wherever he goes. It's just Chuan outplaying everyone that he finds.
Now the smoke up, newbie. Instead of just going for the 5-man into the tier 2, which is exactly what Digital Chaos are going to expect, right? They're going to expect there are 4 heroes sitting behind the Slark while he's pressing tier 2. They're going to quickly wrap around into mid and catch Digital Chaos unsuspecting.
The smoke's going to break. Disruptor walked in just close enough for it. Well, they don't realize it's just how many heroes are behind him. KP now right behind Resolution. He's got the Chrono. This time he commits it just on the edge of it. And Resolution, his days are over. No way to get out of that one. He lets the cooldown go just for good measure.
And the advantage of that is, obviously, if you get the pick, Al can still take the tier 2 because of the space you bought him.
Yeah, bottom lane, there goes your tier 2. How it only feels like a couple of minutes ago we picked up that Silver Edge. He's already sitting at 2.9k gold over on that Slark.
Yeah, time to trade out that Ring of Aquila for a Scotty in all due time.
Maybe.
If he's really worried about it, he could get BKB versus the Disruptor, Glimpse and Static Storm, which is obviously DC's biggest counter to him, but...
Oh, he found a different one. He found the Bounty Hunter. With the Dark Pack damage, only just enough... Okay, no it wasn't. I was thinking with one charge, he'd had just enough life to survive. And now the Glimpse gonna drag Hal back, but pounces straight out of the field. His Aegis times out in 1 minute, so even if DC wanted to initiate on that, all they would have done is burn the Aegis of the Immortal. Radiant's middle
tower is under attack. The last outer tower for Digital Chaos is going to be taken without a fight. I think DC have to try and force this. There are two options. You either take this fight now around the tier 2, or you YOLO it for Roshan.
Well, your only option then is to jump in with Mu. He has to get that last Sue off.
Yeah, that's just not going
to
happen.
But you have to wait for Hal's Aegis to also time out, which is another now 20 to 25 seconds until it's gone.
Okay, Digital Chaos have to... There are like so many. Like the list of... If you want to look at like how's Digital Chaos going to win this game, there is a laundry list of things to do. They have to wait till Roshan is up, get the right smoke, 5-man into the Roshan pit, win that team fight, take the Aegis into their own hands, win several more team fights to be able to establish map control and item flow, and then start threatening high ground as soon as possible because, again, there is still the threat of late game for newbie.
Sounds like a walk in the park. You make it sound so easy, bro.
Well, we've seen bigger comebacks in this tournament alone with MVP up against Liquid.
Oh, but boy.
That took MVP turning around their play. Like, they didn't play the first 10, 15 minutes of that game all too spectacularly, and then they played near perfect after that point. And we haven't seen anything like that from Digital Chaos yet.
No. They need everything to work from being 16k in both cold and experience behind. Now they 5-man smoke and try and find something against newbie. And of course, who's on the run which could potentially break it is Hal. He's the man moving in close on the back of that, Silver Edge was off cooldown in 7 seconds time. They don't find the right target. And now as DC, they have to basically do the wraparounds to come in from behind newbie. They're looking with an award just around the pit. and they actually want NewB to walk into them. The funny thing is, NewB doesn't have a ward here. They have no idea the Digital Chaos is sitting here waiting until Slark just... Yeah. Oh, okay, yeah, well, now they know. Now they know. He walked to the cliffside. They realize that DC is behind him. They bring all five heroes down, and they ping that bottom racks.
Yeah, the Shadow Dance losing its passive. Slark immediately back to where he came from, and NewB now know exactly what Digital Chaos was planning. Full wraparound like that. They push down the bottom lane just a little bit more, knowing that DC have given up on that attempt at a team fight and will be forced to defend.
And DC now have to reveal themselves. But of course, with this, we start the countdown again. Just a minute and 20 seconds until Roshan could go down, and they already read the ward positioning. So that observer ward, which DC needed to know when NewB went into the pit to get that good timing on the smoke, it just goes away. They currently, as far as like observer wards go on the map, I don't see, actually, is there any wards? Doesn't really matter when you also find that kill. Hal, making it look way too easy.
Again, Hal securing his lead, picking up the BKB, there's nothing that can stop him. He should always be able to Shadow Dance off any lasso attempt at initiation, and now he can BKB off the Static Storm Kinetic Field combos. So, all that's left, like DC, Blind Smoke, while NewB are trying Roshan.
Yeah.
They have to summon, it's just luck. That's all it is. Because of the Roshan timer, there's such a large gap, and NewB can do it relatively quickly too. They have no vision, they have no idea. They're just gonna have to go, okay, I hope Roshan is up right now, and NewB are doing it inside of the pit, and they have bad positioning. Let's go for the fight.
It's so cruel as well. The last two walls that DC put down, they don't even last 30 seconds until NewB just like, I'm fairly certain I know where they're looking. They take out the observer wall, just watching over the Radiant Agents. They took out that one before in front of the Roche Pit. Like, NewB just control this map, and they are slowly sieging out DC. They don't have supplies for 2 years. They've got nothing right now. They have to look towards Roshan. 1 minute and 15 seconds is on the clock right now before he's up. This is the play for DC. But they know the Roshan could already be up, so they're already coming out. The Kree waves are at least far enough outside the base that NewB might be thinking, hey, they're not going to be there. But okay, yeah, bob-omb. The scan flag's red. NewB no, and NewB will prepare.
Yeah, how? He's going to sit on the front lines. He's going to pop that smoke, I think.
Oh, they haven't done it yet.
Oh, they're actually...
Silver Edge, they move all the way in towards the pit. The Shiva's guard's out.
Yeah,
now
they're going to be
now break. And there it is, three man corner. Catching him out. They see we are inside the pit. The rapid formation from Sean. Hitting the wall. This is DC. 1 foot in the grave. And they're about to be buried by NewB inside the pit. We are going to burn down as well. And this will leave the last man standing. Resolution. He is on the wrong side of the river. And he's gone. SCT and the team wipe. NewB will advance 2-1 against DC. There's still massive props to DC. They took a game off NewB.
I mean, that by itself was impressive. It shows the promise of Digital Chaos, but NewB as a whole, very clearly the dominant team here. Game 1 and Game 3, super one-sided. So much so that one team fight, not even a push or anything like that, is what forces DC to call it in both of those two games. So, NewB, again, still look like the strongest team in the tournament. A little bit of weakness there in game number 2. I think they did make some mistakes. DC were able to capitalize off of that one.